2 Peter chapter 3, beginning in verse 3. Knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lust, and saying, Where's the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. Jump down to verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Let me make this statement this morning. Jesus Christ is about to return to this earth. Jesus is about to return. It's one of the greatest truths you'll find in the Word of God. Time after time, it's promised, it's reiterated, it's confirmed. God says it and says it and says it. Jesus himself declared it in John 14. I go to prepare a place, and if I go and prepare a place, I will come again and receive you unto myself. The angels declared it in Acts chapter 1 as they were standing out on the Mount of Olives looking at Jesus, and he ascends up into heaven. The angels appeared and they said, Why are you standing here staring up into heaven? This same Jesus will so come in like manner as you've seen him go. And then you keep reading through the Word of God. The Holy Spirit confirms it in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. It talks about the Lord descending from heaven with a shout. And it just keeps going. Peter talks about it. Jude talks about it. Jesus talks about it in Revelation. The angels talk about it in Revelation. Jesus is coming back to this earth. Amen. He's soon to come back. I want to tell you that the return of Jesus is, I'm not just going to say imminent, but I'm going to say it's at hand. In fact, it could happen in the next moment. Jesus is coming soon. Now, it's just as Peter was talking, he said, you know, there's in these last days, there's a lot of people say, well, yeah, we've heard that all our life. People have talked about it. Every generation believed that Jesus was about to return. But this morning, I want to give you seven reasons that I know that he's at the door. Any minute. Seven reasons. So go through this with me. The first one is the urgency in the Spirit of God to see the lost saved. You know, the Bible says that the gospel would be preached in all nations before the end came. And I've never seen such urgency in people desiring to get the gospel out. I mean, so many major ministries like Christ for All Nations, Reinhard Bonnke's ministry, you know, they've been focusing in Africa for so long, and so many millions of people in Africa were saved. And now God said, come to America, and began to evangelize this nation. And other major ministries are just redoubling their efforts. And God, it seems, is opening every door imaginable to get the gospel out. I was just thinking about what he's done for us here at church, you know, and opening up that satellite TV ministry to Europe and to parts of Russia and the Middle East and parts of Africa and all over creation. And then, of course, the ministry with the internet and the ministry with the radio station, and now the ministry through Roku. And if you don't know what Roku is, you can talk to Barry about it. Roku is a little box that you attach to your TV if you've got wireless internet, and it picks up TV from the internet and on and on. And now we've got two Roku channels. We've got a channel for the radio station, and we've got a channel for the church ministry. And it just seems that God's opening door after door, and so many different missionaries we've had the privilege to partner with. But God has placed in his people an urgency to get the word out, to spread the gospel by any means possible. All over this world, there's a tremendous urgency in the Spirit of God. And it's what we read here. The reason that God has delayed that coming is because he's long-suffering and not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But there comes a time when God says, that's it. It's time for Jesus to return. So there is a tremendous urgency in the Spirit to get the message out. That's the first thing that stands out in my mind. The second thing that stands out in my mind is the persecution of Christians. There's a verse in John chapter 16 that just jumps out at me. And Jesus was talking, and he said, the time will come that whoever kills you will think that he's doing God a service. And, you know, we're seeing that now. That's John 16 and 2. We're seeing that now. the people that are being martyred because they're Christians are being killed by people who think they're doing God a service. Okay? The people that are doing it believe that to gain the favor of God, you martyr those that are not believers in the same way that they are. So you're seeing, you know, Christians all over the world being persecuted and beheaded, martyred, tortured for their faith. And Jesus said that's exactly what would be happening just before his return. They're thinking they're doing God a service by destroying you. The third thing that jumps out at me is the increase in the attacks of Satan, the obvious attacks of Satan. Now, I'm not going to turn to it, but in Revelation chapter 12 and verse 12, God was speaking and he said, "Woe to the inhabitants of the earth, because the devil is come down to you, being full of wrath, because he knows his time is short." Kind of reminds me of yellow jackets in the fall. Have you ever noticed what yellow jackets do in the fall? They get even more ornery than they are anyway. And man, they just, it just seems like they're so desirous to take out their aggression on somebody. Why? Because they know their time's short. You know, winter's coming and they're going to die out. So man, they get really ill. And the same thing is happening with Satan. He is just pulling out all manner of stops. And I was thinking about the way that he's attacking, and he's attacking both believers and unbelievers. It really is. He's attacking unbelievers through all kinds of stuff. Do you know there's a suicide every 40 seconds? There's a suicide or an attempted suicide every 40 seconds. If you listen to the police scanner in this area, it's every day you'll hear two or three people that have attempted or succeeded in trying to commit suicide. And that's a spirit. Let me tell you something. It's not something that you just dream up one day. There's a spirit of suicide. And Satan has unleashed that. And it's really strongly coming against unbelievers. And then there's so many other things. Drug addiction and immorality and all kinds of disease. And you name it, it's there. Satan is really coming against unbelievers because he wants to destroy them before they have an opportunity to believe. But Satan's also coming strongly against believers. And you know, I think he's changing his tactics a little bit. It seemed for a long time, and he's not stopped this, but I don't think it's the main emphasis now. His main emphasis was trying to break up families, break up marriages, and he was doing a tremendous job at it. But what I'm seeing now is catastrophic happenings and sickness and disease. Now, you might say, well, you know, you mean to tell me that you think that's the devil? Well, yeah, I pretty much do. And the reason I do, you can find in the book of Job. And I want you to see this morning, and there's a reason I want to share this with you. Job was a man of God. The Bible plainly declares that. He was somebody that loved God, feared God, served God, worshiped God. And, of course, Satan comes to the Lord one day, and God says, well, have you noticed my servant Job? You know, he's righteous, he's upright, and he fears God and hates evil. And Satan says, well, you think he's doing it for nothing? You've put a hedge about him and about his house and everything that he has, and you've blessed everything about him, his substance, and on and on. This is in chapter 1. But he says, if you will touch what he has, he will curse you to your face. The Lord said to Satan, all that he has is in your power. And as you begin to read this chapter, you'll see the catastrophic things that happened to Job. All of a sudden, these people invaded and they stole the oxen and they stole the donkeys and they killed part of his family. And another thing happened, another group comes in, and finally there's this tremendous wind that comes in and knocks down a house and kills people. Catastrophic occurrence, folks, is the handiwork of the devil. All right? Then you get over into chapter 2, and Job still maintains his integrity, and Job is still talking about, he's worshiping God, even though he's lost his economic nest egg and he's lost his family. And Satan says, yeah, but I'll tell you what, God, if you touch his body, then he will curse you to your face. And listen to this. The Lord said to Satan, he's in your hand. Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord and smote Job with sore boils from the sole of his foot to the crown of his head. That's where disease comes from. disease comes from the results of sin, but it's the handiwork of Satan. And that's the reason I believe with all my heart that God tells us as believers to pray for people to be healed, to pray for people to be delivered from sickness and infirmity, because it's the work of the devil. And the Bible says Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. So that tells me that we have the authority to pray for healing. It tells me that we have the authority to cry out to God and say, Lord, deliver from this affliction, because it's the handiwork of the enemy. God's kingdom is a kingdom where there's health. It's a kingdom where there's fullness of joy and fullness of life. And sickness, disease, and death is from the kingdom of darkness. And that's why we are to be coming against that in Jesus' name. So I'm seeing believers that are being afflicted with sickness and disease. I'm seeing believers that have catastrophic occurrences in their life. And it's obviously to me that Satan is working overtime, and he's wide open because he knows his time is short. And the reason his time is short is because Jesus is shortly coming. Amen. That's why things are as they are. So the first thing that tells me it's at the door is this urgency in the body of Christ to preach the gospel, to get it out by all means to every place that we can take it. The next thing, of course, is the persecution that's coming against Christians all over the world, and the way that we may not be being beheaded in this country, but we're seeing a lot of anti-Christian things happening. And folks, if there's not revival and if there's not a great move of God, we'll see the same thing happening here that you're seeing over in the Middle East. You can bank on it. The third thing is the increase in the attacks of the enemy. The fourth thing is confusion in national leadership. Over in Luke chapter 21, I'm not even going to turn to it, but it's verse 25. Jesus was talking about what would be taking place just before his return. He said, on earth, distress of nations with perplexity. And as you look around, you know, people don't know what to do. You listen to what's coming out of Washington. Well, we don't have a plan to deal with that. We don't have a strategy right now. When you listen to what's coming out of the different parts of the world, everybody's confused. They don't know how to handle the issues. They don't know how to handle what's going on. They don't know what to do about the economic situation. They don't know what to do about ISIS and radical Islam. They don't know what to do about, you know, the surge of immigration that's coming in, and on and on and on. We don't know what to do. So it's just exactly what Jesus said, distress of nations with perplexity. Perplexity is just total confusion. And that's what we're seeing. It's so predominant everywhere you look. The fifth thing that stands out at me is the hatred of Israel. The hatred of Israel. Look with me at Luke chapter 21. Jesus was talking, and this, of course, again, is in his dissertation on how things would be just before he returned. Luke 21 verse 17, he said, you'll be hated of all men for my name's sake. And he was talking to a Jewish audience, remember, at this time. In verse 20, he said, when you see Jerusalem compassed with armies, know the desolation is nigh. Verse 22, these are the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. You see, when these things are taking place, it tells us that the return of the Lord and the fulfillment of all things is at hand. There's such a resurgence in anti-Semitism all over this world. The Jewish people are being hated in every nation. They're being persecuted in so many nations. And Israel is surrounded by armies. Israel is surrounded by the different Arab nations bent on one purpose, and that's the absolute destruction of Israel. So the hatred of Israel is the fifth thing that just jumps out at me, that saying Jesus is coming any minute. The sixth thing is the resurgence or the return of Russia to power. Now you remember, not that many years ago, the Soviet Union fell apart. And Russia became anemic. Russia became just a ghost of what it had previously been. But it had to regain power. Turn with me to Ezekiel chapter 38. We're seeing Russia begin their conquest again to cause that power block to be brought back together. So in Ezekiel chapter 38, it's talking about the army that's going to come against Israel. But the verses I want you to see this morning begin in verse 14. He said, Son of man, prophesy and say to Gog, thus saith God, in that day when my people Israel dwell safely, shall you not know it? You will come from your place out of the north parts, thou and many people with thee, all of them riding on horses, a great company and a mighty army, and you will come up against my people Israel as a cloud to cover the land, and it shall be in the latter days. And I will bring thee against my land, that the heathen of the nations may know me, when I shall be sanctified in thee, O Gog, before their eyes. And if you want to go, if you want to know more about it, back up in that chapter, and you'll see the confederacy that's going to be assembled, and it's even now assembling, but the center focus is this nation that occupies the northern part, and religious scholars down through the years have determined that to be the nation of Russia, and nations that are confederates with it. And as you look, what we're seeing right now is Russia on the move to reclaim Ukraine. Ukraine, the breadbasket of Europe. It was the nation that fed Russia, basically, because it's so fertile, and the food production is so incredible from Ukraine. So, you know, been all these debates about, no, these are nationals doing this, but satellite pictures show columns of tanks going into Ukraine from Russia. So Putin is on the move, and he's going to start rebuilding his empire, and I don't think anybody's going to withstand him. He has to do it because of what God has said in his word. So to me, that's another thing that says the coming of Jesus is at the door. That's the sixth thing. The seventh thing is this: dead churches and a false gospel. Dead churches and a false gospel. Over in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, Paul was writing, and he told what would be taking place in the last days. And I'll read this to you, 2 Thessalonians 2. Well, we can actually begin in verse 1. Now we beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus and by our gathering together unto him, that you be not soon shaken in mind or troubled, neither by spirit or word nor by letter, as from us that the day of the Lord is at hand. What he meant, that literally means, has come to pass. There was somebody, people were going out and saying Jesus has already returned, etc., etc. Let no man deceive you by any means, that day will not come except there come a falling away first. And that word of falling away in the Greek is apostasia. And it literally means, of course, apostasy. And it means a defection from the truth. It means a falling away. And as you look at what's being preached and taught in so many places, there's a false gospel that's going out. There's a weakened down gospel, a gospel that pretty much is a license to sin, that God is a God of love and there's no judgment, there's, you know, whatever. And because of a powerless gospel, you've got a powerless church. You've got a church where the power of God is not being demonstrated. You've got churches that are becoming social institutions, social clubs. And we've got to realize that's exactly what God said would happen in the last days. The apostasy is here. The falling away is here. So as we look across this world, everything that God said would be happening just prior to Jesus' return is here and now. It's here. So Jesus could come in the next second. There's nothing that needs to be fulfilled before the Lord returns. All right. So that's the reason I believe not only that he's coming, but he's coming any minute. Now, let me get you to think on these things. There's so much more evidence in the Word of God. It's just a mountain of evidence. But what will happen when Jesus returns? What will happen? Well, back up one book. We were in 2 Thessalonians. Back up to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 16. Here's what will happen. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore comfort one another with these words. Now remember, Paul was writing this to a church. Okay? That's why he said, comfort one another with these words. because he's writing to believers. But let me tell you something, if you're not a believer, if you've not been saved, if you haven't been born again, if you haven't committed your life to Jesus, these are not comforting words. And I'll tell you why they're not comforting words. What's going to happen is all of a sudden, the Bible says in the moment, in a twinkling of an eye, God will sound that trumpet. Jesus Christ will just step out in the clouds and call for his people to come here. There's an awesome picture of this over in Revelation chapter 4 where John says, I saw a door open in heaven and a voice saying, come up here. And immediately I was in the Spirit and I was in heaven. And that's the way it's going to be. There's going to be a tremendous transition. And the Bible says that once the trumpet sounds, the dead in Christ will be caught up with him. That means the people that have passed on but were believers. Now their spirit's already there. Their body's going to join with the Spirit again. And then believers are going to be instantly transitioned from this earth into heaven. It's going to happen in a moment in the twinkling of an eye. That's good news for a believer. Man, this mortal body will put on immortality. This corruptible body will put on incorruption. Death will be swallowed up in victory. We will be in the presence of God where there's fullness of joy and at his right hand are pleasures forevermore. We will be there never to be separated again, joined with loved ones and relatives that knew Jesus when they left this world. There were the saints of all ages and the hosts of heaven in the very presence of Jesus, God the Father and God the Holy Spirit. It's a pretty awesome thing. All right, now that's for believers. But what about those that haven't accepted Jesus when that moment occurs? Well, I'll tell you. All of a sudden, relatives and friends are going to vanish before your eyes. They're just going to disappear. Here's a thought that most people don't think about. Babies are going to vanish. Think about that. All of a sudden, you're holding your little baby and it's gone. Now, why is that? Because those children haven't reached the age of accountability. God knows what's about to take place on this earth, so they're going to be taken to be with him. Can you imagine the terror, the confusion that's going to be taking place? Babies are gone. Mom and dad that knew Jesus are gone. Brothers and sisters that knew the Lord are gone. Friends and relatives that knew the Lord are gone. All of a sudden, millions of people are going to vanish from the face of the earth. People are going to be running to and fro trying to find those that are gone and trying to find answers for what has just happened. That's the first thing that's going to happen. The next thing that's going to happen is this. The churches are going to be packed out. And they're going to be packed out because so many people that knew the truth but did not respond to it. So many people that heard the gospel preached but never bowed their knees, confessed their sins, and asked Jesus to be their Savior. So many people that put other things before him, they heard it, they knew it. Maybe mom and dad, maybe a relative, maybe they came to church, whatever. Maybe they sat in church every Sunday but still had not repented and asked Jesus to be their Savior. Folks, those people are going to pack the church out the day after the rapture takes place. And there's a lot of people going to be saved. There'll be a tremendous revival that takes place because of what's happened. And that's good. But folks, listen, life is going to be hell on earth. It's going to be hell on earth for those that believe after Jesus returns. Because the Bible says the moment the rapture happens and those people disappear from the earth, the Antichrist is going to step forward and assume power. You see, God said what will happen is there's going to be a great deception. There's going to be this theory, and I can almost picture this, you know. Here's the news media. CNN is broadcasting. Somebody said Fox will probably be gone. Now, I don't know about that. But I'm kidding. CNN will be broadcasting, and you can just see, you know, one of these guys, Wolf Blitz or somebody, I don't know. You know, he's out on the street and he's interviewing people and, you know, what do you think happened? What happened? What happened? And they get some expert to come up there. Well, I think the aliens invaded, you know. And I think they transported all these people off the planet because they were problems. They were troublemakers, you know, and now we're going to have unity and peace because these problem people have been taken somewhere to be reconditioned. Or, you know, maybe they get another expert to come along and he says, well, I think what happened is we passed through a wormhole and, you know, just certain random people, you know, right off the planet and, you know, on and on. And it's just all kind of insanity. And the thing is, people will buy it. Because when you're desperate for an answer, you will grasp at a straw. God says he'll send them a strong delusion. And I tend to believe that the UFO thing is probably going to be the one, because we've been programmed so much, man. Movie after movie after movie about, you know, an alien invasion or whatever. But anyway, we're going to have somebody step forward to say, don't worry about it. I'm at the helm. We can get things back in order. And this man's going to come forward, and he's going to appear to be a man of peace and a man that can bring unity in among the nations and peace to Israel with their Arab neighbors. Probably even somebody that says, you know what, I'll just to show my good faith, we're going to rebuild the Jewish temple there on Mount Moriah. And it probably will sit right beside the Mosque of Omar, you know. Probably because there's room, and probably because I think, after having walked on that mount and looking at how it's laid out, the Bible talks about how the temple was right. You went straight through the eastern gate and into the temple. And if you do that today, you don't end up where the mosque is. You end up just to the north of it. And I believe that that's where the temple of God's going to be rebuilt. But anyway, this man's going to step forward, and he's going to come on the scene as a savior. He's going to come on the scene as a peacemaker, a unifying force. And that's what he'll be. He'll be a unifying force. But in a short period of time, the world will find out that they've got the devil and not God in that position. Because very soon he's going to require that everybody take a mark to show who they are and to show their allegiance to him. The Bible says either in their forehead or in their right hand. And without that mark, you can't buy and sell. Without that mark, you can't hold down a job. Without that mark, you can't own property. Without the mark, you can't buy medicine. Without the mark, you can't buy food. Without the mark, you're nobody. But if you take the mark, the Bible says you're destined to eternal damnation. So as a Christian, after the rapture, you're in a heck of a mess, because you can't get medical attention. You can't get the medicines that you need. You can't get the food that you need. You can't have a job. You can't own property. You can't do anything except run for your life. Can you imagine what that would be like? It would be hell on earth. Other things are going to happen too. That moment that the rapture took place, man, cars that were driven by Christians, buses, tractor and trailers, aircraft, they're going to crash because there's nobody at the controls. Man, it's going to be a scary time. People will be running in all directions. It will be the greatest turmoil this world has ever known. Jesus is coming, and he's coming soon, at any minute. Are you ready? Do you know him? Have you accepted him? Have you bowed your knee and said, God, I'm a sinner. Man, I've messed up. There have been so many things I've done in my life that are wrong. Lord, would you forgive me? Lord, I want Jesus to be my Savior. I want to be ready. I want to be ready for his return. I want to read this as I close this morning. Jesus was talking again in Luke chapter 21. And after he gave all those signs of his coming, he said this. He said, take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting and drunkenness and cares of this life, so that that day come upon you unawares. For as a snare shall it come on all them that dwell on the face of the whole earth. Watch you therefore, pray always, that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. And there's only one way that you can be worthy. It's not if you've been good enough. It's not if you've given enough. It's not if you've done enough or been enough. It's only by bowing your knee to the Lord Jesus Christ, confessing your sin, and asking him to be your Savior. When we put our hope and our faith and trust in him, then his righteousness becomes ours. And our place in heaven is prepared, and our names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. I'm not telling you that you can't be saved after Jesus returns. You certainly can, and millions of people will be. But I'm telling you that you will probably not survive, because those that don't receive the mark, for a period of time, they'll be persecuted, and they'll have to try to figure out how to survive without all the basic necessities. But the time will come, the Bible says, when those that will not bow to him, the Antichrist, will be put to death. So folks, now's the time. That's why the Bible says this is the day of salvation. This is the accepted time. This is the day of grace. This is the day that God stands there and says, come on, come to me now, so that when the moment happens and I step out and say, church, come home, that you'll be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. You'll be caught up with me, and you won't have to go through all these things that are about to take place. Folks, it's not bad enough that the Antichrist is going to be in power and that you can't buy or sell or get medical attention. But as you read through Revelation, once God's judgment begins on this earth, and it will shortly start, all hell will break loose. The Bible talks about, you know, the very stars falling, and what God's talking about is going to be those tremendous meteorite impacts upon the earth. It talks about the fact that the water is going to be contaminated, the sea is going to be contaminated, the green things are going to be destroyed. It talks about all kind of demonic infestation that's going to be loose to torment people, and it just gets worse from there. So listen, you don't want to go through that. And the good news is you don't have to go through that. The good news is this, and it's the gospel. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The Bible says, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. Escape the things that are coming upon this earth. It's up to us. Man, when that rich man opened his eyes in hell, tormented in the flame, he remembered every opportunity that he had to accept Jesus. And he said, send somebody to tell my brothers, to warn them that they don't come here. Folks, we're being warned now. The Word of God is warning us. The very happenings in the earth about us is warning us. Every person that stands in the pulpit to proclaim the truth of the Word of God is warning people. Jesus is coming. He's coming soon. Everything is about to break loose on this earth. Believe today. Accept him today. Put your faith in him today. Ask for forgiveness today. Don't put it off. We don't know. We don't know what's going to happen. It's like we were talking earlier. One of my friends, his wife was talking to him on the phone, short period of time, went and laid down and instantly passed away. Instantly. No warning whatsoever. We don't know what's going to happen in the next moment. We don't know. So please, it's just like Jesus said, pray always that you may be counted worthy to escape the things that are coming upon this earth and stand before the Son of Man. Are you ready for Jesus to come back? Are you ready? Bow your heads, please. Father, I thank you that your word is that lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Lord, I'm so thankful that your word tells us about your great love for us and your mercy and your amazing grace, and it tells us what you've done so that we can escape the torment that's about to be unleashed on this planet. Lord, you tell us what can be done that we might have a way of escape and into the presence of God where there's joy forevermore. And Lord, you tell us what is about to take place here for those that do not accept Jesus. And all through your word, you tell us that he's coming, and you've given us the things, the signposts, the guides to look for, to know when that is imminent. And Lord, we see every one of them now. So Lord, I pray for every person sitting in this room and every person that will be listening to this message on the radio or on the internet or on television. And God, for every one of them that has not made their peace with you, for every one of them that's not acknowledged the Lordship of Jesus Christ, for every one of them that's not said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner, I repent, forgive me, I believe on Jesus, I ask him to be my Savior, let this be the moment that they pray that prayer. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Forgive my sin. I believe in Jesus. I accept him to be my Savior. I ask him to come into my heart, and I give my life to him. God, let that be now for every one of them. And as our heads are bowed, for those of you that are sitting in this sanctuary, if you don't know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you are ready for that trumpet to sound, for Jesus to call you home, if you have any doubt at all in your mind that you are not ready and right with God, this is the moment. This is the moment to be sure. But the good news is, you can be. You can be absolutely certain and absolutely sure. The Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. The Bible says that we, if we're willing to believe in our heart and confess Jesus Christ with our mouth, we'll be saved. So I want to give you that opportunity today. I don't want anyone to leave this earth or to go through what's about to take place when they've had an opportunity to accept Jesus. So as your head's bowed this morning, if you want to commit your life to Him, and if you've not done that, or if you're just not sure, or if you want to recommit your life, I want you to raise your hand and say, God, here I am. Here I am, Lord. Here I am. Here I am. Thank you, Father. Thank you for those hands, Lord. Lord, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that you're saying, you come to me and I will accept you. I will forgive you. I will hold you in my arms. So, Lord, for those that raised their hands this morning, for those that needed to raise their hand, Lord, I pray that you do a work in their heart right now. God, I pray in Jesus' name that you wash them and cleanse them. I pray that you fill them with the Holy Spirit. God, I pray that you write their names in heaven if they're not written there already. And Lord, I pray that you work in them a new work that would give them a boldness to tell the world that they have accepted Jesus as Savior, that they've repented of their sins and they're living for Him. And Father, I pray that you give them a heart to share that good news with others so that others might know and others might escape. Father, I love you this morning and I thank you that you've made a way that we don't have to go through the torment that's about to take place. But Lord, we can be with you forever in a place of fullness of joy. Lord, I ask you to bless each one that's here, each one that's listening. And Lord, minister to them at their point of need. Lord, I thank you for amazing grace. In Jesus' name, I pray. And everybody said, amen. Praise the Lord.